Hello, and welcome back. So from here on out, we're going to be focusing on Y86 rather than X86. So X86, as we talked about, is this sort of huge, ginormous instruction set that has evolved over multiple decades and has all sorts of things in it, much of which is primarily for legacy support. And so I like to use this comparison here with the Swiss Army knives. So the comparison is a little comical, but I think it's apt that x86 is kind of a jack of all trades. It's got everything in it, but it's also enormously complex and hard to learn, at least all of it. And so what we're going to be doing for the rest of the semester, and particularly in projects 3 and 4, is focusing on a smaller ISA that is similar to x86, but not a strict subset, and it's called Y86, and it was sort of invented by your textbook authors, and we've modified it just a little bit, but that's what we're going to be focusing on from here on out. So here is just a brief overview. We've seen this before. I showed this to you as a sneak peek when we finished our discussion of x86. So here is the sort of description of the machine down here in the lower right. So we have registers. You'll see we only have up through R14. But otherwise, we have the same registers that we did in x86. There are only 3 condition codes that we care about now. So we'll have a zero flag, a sign flag, and an overflow flag. These mean the same thing that they did in x86, so nothing's changed there. We also have a program counter, which is the same as our IP in x86. We have a status code indicator that is going to be one of these 4 values, so either AOK, halt, invalid address, or invalid instruction. And then we're going to have some region of memory that we can read to and write from. So these are the register ID numbers. So this is how the different registers are encoded in the instructions themselves. And then here are the instructions. You'll see there are very few of them, so much fewer than in x86. So we have halt, which ends execution. We have no op, which does nothing. We have sort of 4 different movement instructions. This one is kind of an interesting special case in that it can also be a conditional move. It can be a conditional move if there's if sort of the low order 4 bits is not 0. So in any case, I guess the point here is that we have different addressing modes, and those different addressing modes are actually different instructions. So unlike with move in x86, we're going to have different kinds of instructions for different kinds of moves. So for instance, this is a register to register move. This is an immediate to register move. And then this is a register to memory, and this is a memory to register move. And so they've been named according to what they do. So the register to register is RR move Q. The immediate to register is IR move Q, and so forth. So these are the instruction encodings over here, and we'll look at that a little bit more on the next slide, but basically these are the bytes laid out in little endian format. So this is the first byte, and then this is the second byte, and then so forth. And you can see that some of these instructions only require 1 byte, some of them require 2 bytes, and some of them require up to 9 or 10 bytes. And the ones that require 9 or 10 bytes include an 8-byte immediate value. So the other instructions include some arithmetic and logic operations. So there are only 4 of these. And here are the codes down here. So there's an add, there's a subtract, there's an AND, and an XOR. So there's a lot of stuff missing here, which means that in order to do those things like multiplications or regular ORs, you're going to have to assemble that based on the instructions that you do have to work with. We have a jump instruction, just like we did in x86, and we have several different forms for that. Not quite as many as we did in x86, but we do still have a decent number to use there. The conditional move that I talked about before, which is really kind of a register-to-register move, but with a condition attached to it, so it's encoded very similarly. We have call and return instructions for doing procedure calls. And then we have push and pop instructions for manually manipulating the stack. There's also an instruction that we're going to be adding that is not in your textbook, and this is so that we can do a little bit of input and output in our program. This is the IO trap instruction. So this takes a particular ID number that tells the machine to do some sort of input or output. We're not going to work with this too much, but it will come up, and there will be an opportunity for you to implement that as part of the highest grade level in Project 4. Okay, so this is the top of that Y86 quick reference sheet that you should be able to access via the website. So this has all the instructions and how they're encoded in sort of a more succinct form than on the previous slide. And then it also has all of these other things that we saw that talk about how things are encoded in Y86. It also lists the registers that are used for argument passing, and it also lists the IO trap IDs here. So let's take a look at how these instructions are encoded. So for example, here is a program that moves 7 into RCX, 2 into RAX, and then adds that 7 into RAX. So the final result will be that the value 9 will be in RAX. And then it halts. And you can see over here that this is sort of the dump of the individual bytes for each of those instructions. So you can see that the first byte for these first two instructions is 30, which corresponds to the 30, which is the leading byte or the opcode for IR move queue. So that's what indicates to us that it is an IR move queue instruction. The next byte is F1 and F0 respectively. So you can see that high order 4 bits has to be an F. That's what this is telling you right here. So that's the case for both of these, so that's good. That means that it's valid. And then the low order 4 bits is RB, which is the register that's going to be used as the destination. And so here you can see that that register is 1, which encodes RCX, and then in the second instruction, it's a 0, which encodes RAX. And then the rest of this, the rest of this whole byte encoding of this instruction is an 8-byte immediate operand stored, again, in little endian mode. So this is the first byte, and you can see how that encodes the value 7. And then this instruction has 60 as its first byte, which means that it is an operation. And in particular, the particular kind of operation it is an add, because the low order 4 bits is 0, and that indicates that this is an add instruction. The second byte indicates the two registers that are going to be used here. And so we have the high order 4 bits indicating the source register, and the low order bits indicating the destination register. So this is adding register 1 into register 0. And again, if we look this up over here, we can see that this is adding register RCX into RAX. Okay, so that's just a quick summary of how Y86 works. And so in the next video, we will look at some of the utilities that you have for working with Y86 and run through a little demo of using those utilities.